of its flagship program, the Master of Arts in International Economics and Finance. Other programs now include the Master of Business Administration, Master of Science in Finance, Master of Science in Business Analytics, and PhD in International Economics and Finance. In addition to graduate degrees, the Brandeis International Business School is also home to the undergraduate business program, one of the most popular undergraduate majors at Brandeis. In 2008, Lou Perlmutter, Brandeis class of 1956, and Barbara Perlmutter added even more luster to the International Business School when they founded the Perlmutter Institute with the mission to help prepare future global business leaders for what they will face in the real world through the support of research into the teaching of the impact of globalization on business leadership. The Institute acts as a bridge between the theoretical and technical knowledge that students master in their academic studies and the pragmatic skills needed for success in the business and financial worlds. I would like to express my appreciation to Lou and Barbara for their longstanding support of Brandeis University and for their vision in creating the Perlmutter Institute. Honoring Lou and Barbara's vision, the Perlmutter Award is given to a highly select group of individuals who have demonstrated exceptional leadership worldwide. It particularly honors those whose career in business, finance, government, and other related fields embody the values promoted by the Perlmutter Institute. I am proud to be here today to celebrate Aron Ain as we honor him with this award. And now I'd like to invite Dean Katie Grady to tell us more about Aron and his value-driven leadership work.
Thank you, President Leibowitz. And thank you everyone for joining us. My name is Katie Grady. I'm the Dean of Brandeis International Business School and the Fred and Rita Richmond Distinguished Professor in Economics. It is our distinct honor today to present the 2021 Perlmutter Award for Excellence in Global Business Leadership to Aron Ain, the CEO and Chairman of Ultimate Kronos Group. Before I share more about Aaron's background and accomplishments, I'd like to thank the founders of the Perlmutter Institute for Global Business Leadership, Lewis and Barbara Perlmutter. The International Business School is proud to have the Perlmutter Institute as part of our centers and institutes. The center has helped us to be the rigorous, experiential, and global school that we are today. Aron Ain fiercely contends that there is a direct link between employee engagement, customer satisfaction, and business success. And he has proof. When he became CEO of Kronos in 2005, Aron and his team focused on employee engagement as a growth strategy. The result was impressive. As employee engagement scores skyrocketed, Kronos's revenue nearly tripled. In 2020, Kronos and Ultimate Software merged to become UKG, and Aron was named CEO and chairman of the combined company with more than 13,000 employees and $3 billion in revenue. With 50,000 organizations using its software across 150 plus countries, UKG is one of the largest cloud companies in the world and a leading global provider of human capital management, payroll, HR service delivery, and workforce management solutions. A multi-year recipient of Glassdoor's Top CEO Award, Aron believes that anything is possible when people are inspired. That is the underlying philosophy behind his book, WorkInspired: How to Build an Organization Where Everyone Loves to Work, which we will all learn about in just a few short minutes. Aron Ain truly cares about and trusts his people. I learned this firsthand from one of our graduates who works at Kronos and credits Aron with empowering her to advance her career while raising a young family. I read WorkInspired, and its messages helped the International Business School to thrive during the pandemic. Before we present our award and learn more about Aron's book, I would like to invite Dean David Weil of the Heller School for Social Policy and Management to say a few words.
Thank you, Katie. I had the good fortune to meet Aron Ain when, in my early days as Dean of the Heller School, we were the two featured speakers at an event convened by the Jewish Vocational Services to discuss the challenges facing low-wage immigrant workers. I was inspired by Aron's discussion of how he, as the CEO of then Kronos, now UKG, sought to directly address these issues in his local community and in all the places the company operated. A real mensch, I thought. After meeting him at that forum, I decided to read his book, WorkInspired. His book further inspired me in his description of translating high-minded principles into practice and how he and his colleagues at UKG selected, developed, trained, and managed their workforce. As someone who ran the federal agency in charge of enforcing labor standards, I know how important and unusual the high road route he describes and has followed is to both workers and businesses, as well as to the communities that they operate. A real mensch, I thought, as I read it. Since getting to know him, I have also had the good fortune to discuss with Aron difficult issues facing the workforce today. I am consistently impressed by his open attitude and willingness to talk through difficult issues, including how to create more diverse and inclusive communities in organizations. Once again, Aron is a mensch who walks the talk, as he has demonstrated in his work in strengthening the bonds between his business and providing opportunities for work in Lowell, where UKG is headquartered. Aron has also been an early and steady supporter of OGS, a unique program at Brandeis and based at Heller that brings an equal number of Israeli and Palestinian young entrepreneurs to the campus each summer for an intensive 3 months of co-developing ventures. The fellows in the OGS program are mentored by experienced people like Aron as a means to the end of developing a new generation of leaders committed to addressing the deep divides in the region. He has been a dedicated and insightful member of the OGS board under its original chair, Governor Deval Patrick, and now under Ambassador Nick Burns. Finally, anyone who has spent time with Aron knows he is a delightful, exuberant, and optimistic person, as well as a very proud Zeta. I always leave my encounters with Aron in a buoyant mood, thinking, what a mensch. We feel so fortunate to have him as part of the Heller and Brandeis communities. Congratulations, Aron, for this well-deserved honor.
Thank you, David. It is now my pleasure to bestow the 2021 Perlmutter Award for Excellence in Global Business Leadership to Aron Ain. So most of you can see the award now, and I would just like to read that the award is inscribed as follows. It says, Brandeis University celebrates and honors Aron J. Ain, CEO and Chairman, UKG, Ultimate Kronos Group, for excellence in global business leadership. Perlmutter Institute for Global Business Leadership, April 7th, 2021. Congratulations. I will now turn the program over to Aron Ain to say a few words, and then to Professor Aldo Masaccio, Director of the Perlmutter Institute for Global Business Leadership, will lead us in a question and answer session. Thank you.
Thank you, Katie. Thank you. I got my award right here, so I want to, really happy to hold it. Thank you. Nothing like doing this virtually. Excited about it, though. So thank you. Let me start by telling everyone how happy I am to be here. I want to thank my various friends and family and others who have joined this session to help both recognize Brandeis and help recognize the work that we do at Kronos and now UKG. It's an honor for me to receive this award from the Perlmutter family and the Perlmutter Institute. I want to specifically thank Lou and Barbara and tell you the inspiration you give to Brandeis and people like myself to do things that make a difference in the world, really give us a lot of wind behind our sails and a lot of energy to do that. And certainly I have to thank Brandeis. This is all possible because of Brandeis. Ron and Jessica from the president's office and Katie and David, all are my friends and I learned from you and I have this wonderful opportunity to spend time together in helping support Brandeis and all the students who are there. Brandeis, for me, is really an amazing university that does so much for so many with such a purpose and a soul. as someone who has a really high standard of what inspires me, Brandeis inspires me. And that's what gives me extra energy to say thank you for receiving this honor and continue to work on behalf of the principals of the Perlmutter Institute and what Lou and Barbara and Brandeis mean and what they've established. So thank you, thank you, thank you.
I guess that's my cue, Aron.
I think so.
Thank you so much. All right, thank you. I want to congratulate you again, be the second or third person to congratulate you. And it's I want to reinforce the message that the reason why you're the perfect recipient for this award is that Lou and Barbara Perlmutter are very consider business education to be really an interdisciplinary affair. And I feel like when people read your book, it's very clear that someone who only thinks about business cannot really do what you've done. And you really have really this humanistic liberal arts sort of view of what the workplace should be. And I enjoyed reading your book a lot, and I felt it really resounded with the values of the Institute. So thanks so much for accepting it. And
thank you, Aldo.
And I guess I wanted to just get the conversation going. We have like about 150 people out there, and some of them have sent me questions. And the first thing I wanted to say is like, it's obviously amazing that you've done this in this huge corporation, right? It's really incredible. A lot of our students, I read your book and were wondering, you know, this is like maybe looks too far away from them, maybe too distant for them. And I wanted to see if you can scale down a little bit some of the insights of your book for them. Like they're gonna work in smaller organizations, they may start their own companies. Like what two or three things you think they can start putting into place now?
Yeah, thank you. It's a really good question. And I wanna thank the students for participating and reading the book. And I'm not sure if that was a reward or not that they were asked to read the book, but I'm glad they did do that. Let me say a couple things first. It wasn't on my bucket list to write a book about these practices that we have every day at Kronos and now UKG. It really is a reflection of people saying to me, Aron, we do something really special here. We really should share it with others. So that's what led me to do that. Having said that, I believe that trust is the magic glue that holds together personal and professional relationships. I believe it makes everything possible when you trust each other. I think trust is a key ingredient of our success. And I think it's something, although that you can do at a small startup or you can do at a great big company. Everyone has opportunities to interact with other people. And we've all experienced in our personal and professional lives when we meet someone or we have someone who we can tell they trust us and how it liberates us and gives us energy to do more. And so I would tell all the students, that's something you can start practicing when you're students at Brandeis. That's something you can practice when you're home with your families. That's something you can practice with your friends and as you move into your professional careers. And it's important when you're small, and it's even more important, I suppose, when you get bigger. So I think that's a key part. The other thing I'll say, these principles I believe in around transparency and trust and collaboration and honesty and always, always telling the truth, those are principles that always work. You know, they're within all of our grasp when we interact with other people. So there's principles that we follow, that I follow every day, that are the core principles, what I believe has made us successful. You know, they're things that we should be doing all the time. So yeah, I think they're there for those students when they live in their world today and the near future.
And it's very Brandeisian in a way. I feel like these recommendations are very Brandeisian, very in line with the culture at Brandeis. So it fits very well with what we try to do at school in the classes, etc. For me, an interesting perhaps dichotomy or tension in the book is that you push this idea of trust, but at the same time, there has to be like a lot of monitoring. And so where is the line between I trust you to do what you have to do, but I also am going to oversee you and make sure that you're doing it
Yeah, it's a good question, a fair question. Look, I start all my relationships with people I work with by trusting them. They have to unearn my trust. I take an opposite approach of others where someone has to earn my trust. When we hire them or we give them responsibility, we hire them because we trust them and we give them things to do because we trust them. So I'm very comfortable starting my relationships with everyone by trusting them to get the work done. At the same time, we have standards and people are accountable to that. And so we expect people to perform. Now, I also have a focus on not keeping score. And let me tell you what I mean by that. If we give someone something to do or they give us a proposal and we approve it, if it doesn't work, that's okay. That's okay. I tell them all the time, if you're convinced something is a bad idea or not going the way we expect it, then stop doing it. Let's stop throwing good resources at a bad idea. And if I'm keeping score about everything, then people will continue to work on that to absolutely positively prove it was a bad idea. And I don't want them to do that. But I still trust them even after that. Now, if someone keeps giving us ideas to do and we give them resources to do it and it never works out, then at some point I'm going to say, look, I still trust you, but I don't have confidence in you doing this in the same way anymore. So I comfortably hold people accountable and I trust them at the same time and they go together for me. There's really not a mixed message there at all.
There is a question very related to what you're mentioning, but from Alex Park, one of our undergrad students, who's asking, you know, with your philosophy and trust and working with people, how do you approach making hard decisions that will affect those who work with you?
Yeah, so hard decisions are hard. We have a training program that we developed in-house called Courage to Lead. And the action word I tell people in the leadership development program isn't to lead, it's courage. Because it takes a lot of courage to be a great leader. Nobody likes to have difficult decisions with people about things that affect those people negatively. But we teach them they have to do it. And we teach them that it's really hard to do. And we tell them that's why there's an emphasis on courage. And we role play with them. And we give them the confidence to know that if they're feeling uneasy about it, that's okay. That's expected. It's hard. Still need to go do it. And as a leader, we have to have the courage to be leaders. And that means, you know, lead, and that means be prepared and make those difficult decisions. And when we teach them how to do it, you can make difficult decisions that even affect people negatively, but you can do it in a kind, a thoughtful, a caring way, but you need to do it, and you need to do it directly, and you need to do it as soon as possible. I'll also say about it is, I always try to think about if I'm thinking somebody's not doing a good job and if the shoe is on the other foot, would I want someone thinking that I was doing a bad job but not telling me that I was doing a bad job? So I always say, if I would want someone to tell me, then I'm going to tell them. And that also gives me the impetus and the courage to go do that.
And since you're talking about how you train your own leaders to make these hard decisions, something that I found very interesting in the book is that most of the time you're talking about something that is very humane and sort of like something that comes from the heart in terms of how you want people to interact, how you want people to treat each other and to care for each other. And yet I noticed that there is a moment in which you talk about an algorithm that you use to predict whether someone's going to be a good leader, and the algorithm uses artificial intelligence, machine learning, et cetera, et cetera. And so I felt at that moment that I was kind of like, oh, I thought we were talking about, you know, touchy-feely stuff. And then now I suddenly feel like we're introducing robots to make decisions. Is this a tension or is this like a natural fit in your view?
Oh, no robots where I work. We certainly use technology to help us analyze information, but all the inputs into that information are collected from humans. And all the positives and negatives that we deal with in dealing with each other as humans. And so some of those technology help us evaluate based on science and research what kind of people work together most effectively, what are people's basic drives and needs, and then how to teach managers to work with people on their team to effectively bring out the best in each other. But it's all based on human input. And then right along with that, I believe that everyone deserves to have a great manager. I believe people join organizations because of the organization and they leave because of who they work for. Think about your own experiences when you've worked for someone who didn't trust you or you didn't get along with. You said, I just can't stay here no matter how much you love the organization. So we also use those tools to go and help us collect information on what makes a great manager in the eyes of the people who work for them. And we report those results back to those managers using, again, science and information to give them that data so that they can continue to improve. And so no, it's no robots, humans helping humans, and just using a little bit of science and technology to make it a little bit better.
Excellent. And obviously the question of the moment from our fellow Professor Ben Gomez-Cáceres is, how do you see the transition out of this pandemic in terms of work from home? He asked two questions. One, are we going to the before model, or is there going to be something new? And do you see like new forms of collaboration among employees?
Yeah, it's a good question. So look, we have 13,000 people around the world working from home. Imagine that, 13,000 people working from home, from Australia, India, Europe, Latin America, North America. And we're getting our job done and we've learned to work in a new and a different way. And by the way, our business is doing well and we've been able to protect the business and the balance sheet so we could protect our employees and their families and our customers, of course. Having said that, I'm ready for it to go back to the old way with a little bit more flexibility. And let me be more specific about that. We're planning to come back if things continue to improve in the US to start, although we're back in our offices in Australia and New Zealand and Singapore, but in the US where we have the vast majority of our people, June 30th. And we're gonna let our people know that in the coming days so they can get prepared for that with certain protocols and certain rules. Now, why is that? I believe, and we believe, that we collaborate better, we innovate better, we ideate better, we have fun together better when we're together, when we're together. So we already had 40% of our employees working remotely, either full or part-time, because we trust each other. It's another benefit of trust, we can do that. But for the 60% who were in offices before, we're gonna be asking them to come back to our offices and we're gonna be asking them to do much of what we did before, but with more flexibility than maybe we did before. But it's gonna be more like the old way than it is the current way.
I mean, and it's important to mention that in a way you were doing flexibility before the pandemic.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you know what's interesting about that point is I've always believed that I care more about what people do than where they do it or when they do it. Yeah. It goes back again to trust. I care more about what they do. So if they can get their work done at home, I care what they get done, not where they did it or when they did it. So I think it's why we comfortably switched to that. But I still believe what I said before, innovate better, collaborate better, have more fun together around our culture. We have a great culture. It's one of the things that drives us. And it's one of the things we've lost a lot in the past year is that magic culture we've had. We're still doing great with it, but it's not quite the way it was before.
Since you mentioned, you know, the global scope of UKG, I wanted to ask you, the chapters in which you talk about caring for each other ran very close to me. I'm from Latin America. You talk about, look, make sure that you know everyone in the office, you know about their families, about their health, et cetera, which is kind of like the normal procedure where I come from. But I can't imagine how you convince a global corporate, like people in different cultures to basically like sign off and say like, yeah, this is how I'm gonna behave now, which may not be natural for them, no?
You know, we lead by example. Who doesn't want to be cared for and communicated with actively and you know, receive kindness and, I don't know, love from each other and take care of each other? And so it's easier than you think it is once you start doing it. And I have great relationships with the people who work for us all over the world, Latin America, Asia, Europe, all over North America, and try to focus on the person and their family and tell them that that's most important. And I tell people all the time, although that if the most important thing in their life is working for UKG, they have their priorities mixed up. I tell them that's silly. The most important thing in their life should be their families. Now, I want where they work to be important, but the most important thing, no, don't do that. And so if I say that enough, people know I'm serious about it. And you'd be surprised how much they give back to the organization and each other and our customers when they know that we trust them and we care about them and we're committed to being kind to them and we're committed to looking out for them.
Yeah, I also, like Katie Grady, I have many former students who work for you, and they left jobs, you know, in California close to their families to stay there simply because they love the place. So I think I get it. One of our undergrad students, Sichi, is asking that this idea of trust sounds good, but like it's not easy to suddenly give trust to someone. And like, how much is it about selecting the right people, let's say, to get into this culture versus just giving trust to anyone?
Well, of course, it has an impact on selecting the right person, but I've interviewed and hired thousands of people in my career. But I'm never positive when I hire someone if they're really as good as they seem. Yet I still start that relationship with them by trusting them. I still start that relationship with them where they have to unearn my trust. And you know, sometimes it's really interesting. I'll see a situation where I'll watch a manager not trusting someone and I'll grab the manager on the side. I'll say, hey, what's going on with that? What do you mean? I say, well, you don't seem to really trust them as much as you know, I think you should. And they say, well, they just started. They have to earn my trust. And I tell them, but when you hired them, you must have thought you would trust them or else you wouldn't have hired them. I say, give it a chance. I have other situations where people come to me and they say, Aron, could you help me with this? I say, sure. And they tell me a situation and I say, I don't know. What do you think we should do? And they start to explain it to me. And I say, okay, let's do that. And they go, really? And I go, yeah, I trust you. And I watch them. They're uncomfortable. And sometimes I take a physical step closer to them, not actually in their personal space, but pretty close. And I say, no, I trust you. And I watch them get even more uncomfortable. And it just shows me they're not used to it.
Yeah.
But when we start doing it every day, oh my goodness, it's magic what happens. People start saying, I love it here because I can tell they trust me to get my work done. And they trust me to make important decisions. And so, no, I think you just go do it. Go give it a try. I understand why it's hard. Fun to do it.
One of our colleagues, Carol Osler, a professor at the Brandeis International Business School, asked, like, can you elaborate further on why trust is so critical? What happens if you don't have this whole trust idea embedded in the organization?
You know, it just liberates so many other things. So I'll give you a quick story. 2015, we had over 300 open positions at the company. By the way, today we have over 800 open positions, but 3 years ago, 2015, 300, and we were struggling to fill those positions. And I went to the recruiting team and saying, hey guys, come on, we need to fill these positions. They're important positions. And they said, Aron, it's really hard right now. The economy's doing well. There's a lot of competition. I said, okay, well, give me some ideas of what we can do different. They said, let me think about that. They came back a couple of days later and they said, would you ever consider us having an open vacation policy? I said, I don't know, what's an open vacation policy? They said, people can take off as much time as they want. And we don't keep track of it the same way. And the first thing that went through my mind was, oh my goodness, I'm gonna be the only person here if we do that. But they said, no. I talked to other companies and we put in January, 2016, an open vacation policy where people can take as much time off. They can't all go at the same time. They have to get approval so we have coverage. That year, 2016, was the best year we ever had. Lowest turnover ever, highest employee engagement, best financial results. A big difference was we did this open vacation policy. How does it relate to this question? We could not have done that if we did not trust each other. Impossible. But I trust again, I care about what you do more than where you do it and when you do it. And we still today have that policy. Guess what it did? It made our recruiting that much easier. We did it to change our recruiting profile, to differentiate ourselves against other companies that were having fixed vacation times. And so there you go, trust, all the way back to trust.
Yeah, no, and that I love that chapter of the book, because you can see also how the surveys basically changed and how people reacted to this. My colleague also asked something about institutional policies towards bullying. I don't know how much you guys think about that, or if that's just something naturally you don't have to worry about once you have trust and care as a primary sort of like ethos.
The bullying, like bullying at work, people bullying each other?
Yeah.
Oh, that doesn't, we don't accept that. That's an unacceptable, that's a non-starter for us. You wouldn't be able to stay at our company if you did that. Impossible to do that.
And, zero tolerance, basically, is the policy.
Zero tolerance. So zero tolerance for a lot of things. People who work with me know, if you want to get on my bad side really quickly, don't tell the truth. Like, if there's bad news, tell me the bad news, tell me the truth, but don't fib to me. It's hard enough, don't fib to me, kind of thing. I have no tolerance for that. We're very focused on diversity these days. We want to be a leader in all aspects of diversity, all aspects of it. And we've done great in historically in some areas, and there's areas that we want to improve even more. We have no tolerance for examples of not being supportive and exhibiting behavior that shows we support diversity in all of its important ways. It's not, by the way, it's not just that we have better results because we're more diverse. That's a nice product. We're diverse because it's the right thing to do. It's the right way to lead our professional lives. And so we're trying to teach our employees, and hopefully they'll teach their family and teach our communities of the value of being diverse. We've been doing this for a long time, and we've just scratched the surface. So we have no tolerance when you don't do that either.
And David, while it's actually adding to this, asking about, like, can you tell us a little bit about your approach to diversity at UKG, in terms of, you know, what we're seeing right now in the world, the situation we're living right now? Like, can you tell us a little bit about what kind of policies you have? How do you see that diversity as an issue right now?
Yeah, so it's a complex, multidimensional question, as David knows, and I appreciate him asking me it. We've always had a focus on diversity. We have communities of interest at the company, whether it's around women issues, gender, race, ethnicity, age, you can go on in different areas. And we create programs and encourage allies to support those areas and do more. But, you know, what's happening today, which is a little bit different than 2 or 3 years ago, we were very internally focused on diversity historically. And today, particularly in the past year or so, we've become much more focused externally on diversity to be an example for other corporations, other organized businesses, of what they can do in areas of diversity. I personally don't think that in parts of our society where we need to have leaders show more leadership in this area, they're doing as good of a job as they need to. So I feel a calling to go help lead our organization to do this. So that might be in the specific form of pay equity. We've always been focused on pay equity, so that we have no issues where there's gender pay imbalance. We did our survey a couple of years ago when Massachusetts required gender pay compliance proof. And we didn't just do it for our Massachusetts employees, we did it for all 5,000 global employees. And we didn't have to change one person's pay. It means we were right there. Other CEOs went on and said, we did that and we found out that we were paying women less than we should have. And they were given, you know, TV interviews as heroes. I was saying, why can't I get to go on TV and say, we didn't have to change anything? We did it right from the beginning. So that's just one example. You know, in the last 3 or 4 years, more than half of all of the people we've either hired or promoted to officers of the company, vice presidents, are women. And so in our technology business, the average number of women in those roles is 32%. Here we are, 50%. And so it's intentional. We can't do this without being intentional. Big focus right now on race. We take this very seriously. We've created a build program, a Black leadership development program. We're just not counting on the educational institutions or other companies to prepare the generation of specifically Blacks to go assume important leadership roles. We're taking it upon ourselves to develop leadership programs in those areas, to teach our managers what it means to have difficult discussions about race specifically, or parts of diversity questions. And so I can go on and on. We're just scratching the surface and deeply, deeply committed to it. Again, not because we do better because we're more diverse, which we do, but because it's the right thing to do. I don't need any other reason that it's the right thing to do and that everything else takes care of itself.
Yeah, well, thank you. That's a great answer. And related to this, one of our graduate students from Afghanistan is asking, like, you know, thank you for being here, congratulations. But then he's asking, like, how can we, like our students who are learning these fantastic things, become ambassadors and develop this kind of culture, work culture in their home countries where maybe the common practice is very different?
Look, this is hard. Again, courage to lead. It takes courage to be this great leader in different ways. And you're blessed that you have an opportunity to be at one of the finest universities in the world, like Brandeis. It's not a throwaway statement, and be part of the international school here and what it represents. And you have to just listen and learn and then go back and have the courage to go put them in motion. One person, one woman, one man can make a huge difference, whether it's Afghanistan or Waltham, Massachusetts. And I encourage you to have the courage to go do that and influence people to see your way. And then lead by example. I get more done by leading by example than I do because of my role and my influence and my authority. So like communication, when I'm walking in the hallways, when I can't wait to go back to my office, my cell phone's in my pocket, my head is up, and I'm talking and communicating and catching up with people in the hallways as I'm on the move around. I'm paying attention. Little things like that make a difference.
Excellent. That's a fantastic answer. And we have, it's a little bit like a change of gears, but somebody's Madvi Maslov, who's in Moscow right now, I guess in the middle of the night, he's asking us, okay, so how does trust between employees impact the decisions made during conflicting situations? Does it make it easier to sort of disarm or sort of solve those kinds of conflicting situations?
Yeah, I think it makes it much easier because people don't have hidden agendas that we don't know about. We encourage people to go and say what's on their mind, tell the truth, be transparent. And so then let's deal with fact. I have a concept that I live by, which I call exposing reality. I can deal much better with a set of decisions if I know what the facts are. And so I encourage our people, let's expose the reality of what's really going on right now. Not what we want it to be, not what we wish it would be, not what it's not, but what it is. And if we can do that, then we can solve problems quicker. And that requires trust to do that at times. And so, yeah, I think it's a key part of it. If we don't trust each other, then we're not going to expose reality. If we don't expose reality, we're going to go spend too much time trying to figure out what's really going on to make a decision.
So here's a question that may be hard for you. This comes from Caroline Master. She's, how does one go about finding companies or organizations who value trust and the other attributes that we have been discussing?
I'm not positive how to do that. If I was going to start from scratch, I certainly go look at things like how organizations are ranked. And so, you know, just last month, we were Forbes listed their top 500 places to work for through random surveys of employees, thousands, tens of thousands of employees. And they called up and said, we want to let you know we're going to announce tomorrow the top 500 places to work for. And they say, you're going to get announced as number two. And I'm going, number two? You must be wrong. I'm in the middle of doing a merger in the middle of a pandemic. And there's no way we're number two. And they said, yep, number two. That's how you were rated by both people who work at your company and people who have heard about your company. And so that's a good place to start. Also, you can start by talking to people and listening to people and what do they know, and do that. And then, you know, we all develop better judgments as we go through our own life journey. So sometimes I would say, judge the people who you're talking to, but sometimes we don't always have good judgment, particularly when we're early in our career. I know I didn't. And so I think that's an imperfect way to do it. I would focus most on who your manager is. I go back to that basic principle. People join organizations because of the organization. They leave because of who they work for. I would, like when my kids were looking for jobs, I would tell them, go talk to other people who work for that manager. Go on LinkedIn, go here. You got to find some people who work for that person and see what those people think about that specific manager who you're going to work for. So I think that's important as well, but I don't have a perfect answer to the question.
Yeah, no, that was a great answer. And Caroline wrote that saying thank you. And also she's a Brandeis undergrad class of 1974. Wow, okay, fantastic.
Thank you, Caroline.
There is a question that we love to ask to guests when we have students interacting with guests like yourself, which is one key question is, what do you wish someone like yourself had told you when you were a student, right? That would have prevented a big mistake you made or something that you wish somebody had told you when you were at school that would have changed your life in a significant way. And
people ask me that.
Now you want to convey it to our students.
The answer is that if somebody had told me, I'm not sure I was prepared to accept it and receive it and react to it. Let me try to shift the question a little bit and say, what are things that you did earlier in your career that you learned that you wouldn't do again if you know what you know now? One of the things was I expected everyone to want to work as hard as I did and be as into it as I was into it. You know, 6-7 days a week and just, you know, always on. And I learned after a while that not everybody wanted to be like me. And that was okay. And they could still be great, productive employees and wonderfully productive peers and coworkers. And so I probably aggravated some people when I was a young manager by getting frustrated that they weren't, you know, into it like I was into it. And I give the credit to this one young man who was roughly my age. I was like 24. And I had all these people working for me, and he sat me down, and he was my friend at that point. And he just said, Aron, I don't want to be like you. I went home and I thought about that. And I said, you got to do better, Aron. You got to do better. So I will say this, that would encourage you. I think humility and being humble and understanding that you don't have a corner on the market of all the best ideas. And if you can let people who you work with make you a more effective peer and coworker and manager and leader, you will be. So the sooner you start doing that, the sooner you're on a track to be more effective than you otherwise would have been.
Fantastic. And you mentioned this idea of like, look for a manager, not for a job, like, right? Maybe thinking about, you know, especially our students, they love to find good mentors and things like that. One of our students from Nepal, Ishan, is asking, you know, I'm still working hard to find what I love. What advice would you give me? He's an MBA student.
So the advice I would tell you to start with is try to find a job in an industry or an organization or something that you really love to do. Like, I'm not sure if I had to do it again, I'd be doing what I did. I don't think I thought about that. It's like when I was in college, I wished that I hadn't decided to just be a double major in economics and government. I wish I decided to be a single major, taken just the minimum amount of courses to complete that major, and then took a diverse set of courses in all these other things that I would probably never do in the rest of my life, just to go advance my, you know, knowledge. And so like when my kids went to school, I said, you know, go and enjoy college, go take lots of things, whether you think they're gonna help you in the future or not, just to expand your horizon and your world from that perspective. So yeah, it's not a perfect answer to the question, but it helps how I think about that.
Of course. I have to ask you a kind of like a very close to home question, which is that we're very fortunate to work with your sister, and she's amazing at coaching. And then we hear you, and then you have all this amazing advice. So is there something in your is there something that runs in the family that made both of you so sort of like prone to see people in a different way and to think about the development of people in a different way? Because it's kind of amazing that both of you have all these amazing perspectives, and your sister brings this, Alice brings this to us at the business school. Yeah.
Well, look, my secret weapon is my sister. We're 13 months apart. I'm number 4, she's number 5. And she's been a great coach and teacher for me my whole life. And so I get too much credit. She probably deserves more of the credit than I do. And so we learn off of each other. But I think it goes back to, we're 1 of 5 kids, like I said, and 2 of 5 kids. And we had fantastic parents, and are truly fantastic parents, remarkable parents. They taught us the value of taking care of each other, taking care of others who are less fortunate than us, making the world a better place. They led by example, and it just rubbed off on us. But I think it's also in our soul a little bit from that perspective. It, you know, I do what I do because it gives me joy. I don't do what I do because I have to. Alice does what she does because it gives her joy. She doesn't do what she does because she has to. And so it makes it a lot easier when you do it that way. So great parents, great siblings. I still talk to every one of my siblings like 5 days a week, no matter where I am in the world, in one form or another, texting, talking, communicating. You know, like when two of the five might not be getting along, my mom would like call me up, because I tended to be more of the peacekeeper. And she'd say, I need you to get in the middle and tell those two to cut it out. I say, Mom, why do I have to do that? Tell them to get fixed. Because I told you, I don't like this. So I call them up and say, I'm not going to get in the middle of this with Mom calling me up. You guys cut it out, like right now, cut it out. And so maybe that helps as well.
Thank you for sharing this. And one thing that is curious in your book is you talk about what you've done inside the company. And then you talk about how you try to send this to your customers, to your clients, right? To sort of like export the culture. But I would think that is probably the hardest thing to do. Like, how do you export what you do very well inside to your clients who may have completely different work culture?
You know, it's a really, really great question. Thank you for asking that. I really try not to. Mm-hmm. And so what happens is when I meet with potential clients, like the biggest hospital group in New York or one of the biggest international food and beverage organizations or large car manufacturer, when I go present why they should buy from us, one of the things I tell them is about our culture and a lot of things we were just talking about. And I tell them, I'm telling them this because we'll be a better partner because we have better people who work for us. We have people who are engaged people, better products, better service. Better products, better service, better outcomes. So that's a reason why you should do business with us. Go ask the people who are the competitors how they do this. So then what happens is after the meeting or I present, the execs come up to me, they say, could you come and teach my company how to do that? Could you come give a talk about that? And I always say, we're a software company. I'm not a consulting company. They say, no, we need to do the exact same thing. I say, well, I'm happy to do that, but are you sure you want to ask me to do that? And so I'm actually not trying to go promote and push our strategy and our philosophy and our culture on others. It just makes sense and they want to hear about it. It's one of the reasons why we wrote the book, because my people who I work with kept saying, Aron, you should got to write this down.
Yeah, and I feel like we've been talking about all this positive stuff, and it would be unfair as a management instructor, let's say, not to ask about mistakes, right? Like if you can maybe share with you something like a big mistake that maybe changed your management philosophy. And this is not from me, this actually also comes from someone in the audience, Michael Frietz.
Yeah, so a good question. Look, I've made so many mistakes. I could write a book that's twice as big as WorkInspired on the number of mistakes I've made. But I try to learn from those mistakes, and I try to not necessarily not do them again. I'm human. I'm imperfect. And so I'm going to continue to make mistakes, but I don't let it get in the way. Big mistakes, doing big, you know, multi-million dollar acquisitions that didn't work. I remember one, we did $150 million acquisition, and we ended up selling it, I don't know, 10, 12 years later for $8 million, just the remnants of what it was. So, but we also did another 70 acquisitions that ended up working out great. And so, but that's a big mistake, but it's okay, you know, it goes back to this thing, not keeping score. I'm okay if I make mistakes. I'm okay if the people I work with make mistakes. I tell them, by the way, although we're going to be judged more on how we react to what happened in a negative way than what happened. So can we put all of our time and all of our energy behind fixing what happened as opposed to trying to keep score of why it happened exactly? There'll be plenty of time to do that, but let's fix the problem and move on. I don't want to like hear about who's to blame or why this happened. Let's just fix the problem. And so lots of mistakes, and I'm okay with it. I'm okay. I'm human, imperfect.
Yeah, we have only a few minutes, but there are a couple of questions that, if you don't mind, we want to sneak in. One is, it's about when you started to think about the workplace in a different way. You probably were kind of like a renegade. And do you feel like everyone is moving closer to you, or did you already feel when you started to make changes and you started to change how the philosophy inside Kronos back then, that the world was moving in that direction?
You know, I'm in a little bit of a rut. I've been at the same company now for 42 years. So I actually don't know perfectly what happens in other places. I do know that I felt when I became CEO in 2005, that we perhaps weren't taking advantage of the power of our people enough. So it's just something I felt that I wanted us to do more effectively. We were a good place to work, but we weren't a great place to work. And I thought if we could be a great place to work, we could achieve things that were unimaginable, just, you know, not possible. And so that's really what my focus was. Do I think organizations are moving more to this softer side of leadership? I do. I think in potential employees are smarter and more discerning and have tools to see where they can work. And we want to hire the best people. Other organizations want to hire the best people. If you want to hire the best people, then you better be a great place to work. And you better do all these things we talked about. Because the problem with hiring great people is great people have choices. If you hire people and you don't have an engaged environment, they're going to do what great people can do. They'll get another job. And so that's why we do it. And that's how I feel about it. And I do think more organizations are having to do it, particularly the really good ones.
Yeah. And I feel, since this is an award for global, for excellence in global leadership, I feel like in a way you were ahead of your time in that respect. And
I agree with that.
And you see now CEOs of investment banks where you would never, you know, expect people talking about ESG and the value of people in the same way that you've been talking about. So I think it's very interesting from that perspective to see that the world is converging to your philosophy. And hopefully we will see more of that. I think on the interest of time, I'm going to pass on the baton to President Leibowitz to close the ceremony. It's been a pleasure, really, Aron, having the conversation with you. It's exactly as I expected when I read the book. So thank you so much for
it. Thank you, Aldo. You're a remarkable conversationalist.
You.
So you give me energy having the chat with you. And thanks for all the questions.
It's a pleasure.
I just want to second the thanks to Aldo for conducting that interview. It just flew on by, and I Also want to thank all the questions that came in. Thank the folks who sent all the questions in. They were terrific. I don't know how many came from the students in Philippe's class, but we appreciate them very much. And Aron, congratulations one more time to you. It's well-deserved. I mean, you've done a remarkable job at Kronos. Just remarkable to hear all that's been done. I can't imagine 13,000 employees and thinking about the multiple continents and how the day never sets, the sun never sets for you in thinking about the company. So kudos to you. And last but not least, want to thank Lou and Barbara Perlmutter again for sponsoring this and starting the Institute that led to this conversation and to all that's been done at the business school in this area. So thank you, Lou. Thank you, Barbara. Thank you, Aldo. Thank you, Aron. And thank you everyone else who is here for this event. Thanks a lot.